All right, so chapter 20, chapter 23, and the short name was like business cycles. Now, from last time I made, it's not exactly a mistake, I'll clarify an important difference. It also relates, but in a very different way, to his original comment that what happens to the economy when the government spends a lot more money, meaning the government just runs a bigger deficit, like in the case of a war. And the result of a war is initial boost for the economy. So there is a short-term effect and a long-term effect. The short-term effect is the economy grows rapidly, but then there are long-term negative effects, and it's negative for the economy. Now, we already started from the previous chapters on growth in the financial system, that if the government spends more and runs a deficit, increased borrowing will raise interest rates, and the result will be negative for the economy. So let's try to do this. If there is a G standing for government spending, if G increases, the short-term effect for GDP will be up. This is short-term effect, but the long-term growth effect for GDP is down. Well, how is this happening? Well, it's a simple picture. If this is where the economy is supposed to grow, in the short run, it will have a quick boost, and then it's going to fall below. It's going to fall even below where it was, okay? This is the so-called stimulus effect. You stimulate the economy, in the short run, you get a big boost, but in the long run, the negative effect is even worse. So, in the long run, the economy is worse, but in the short time, it feels good. This is exactly the same with borrowing. Let's say you decide to borrow 10,000 and go shopping. You're gonna feel great, but later on, you gotta pay the interest. So, that's with G. Now, what I tried to do is last time and explain, if you increase prices, I gave you the second effect. If prices increase, this means that the purchasing power money falls, and this means that the exchange rate will fall, okay? And this I already covered last time. It's just got a name.
Purchasing power.
Yes, purchasing power parity. Purchasing power parity. Exchange rate, meaning the currency. Now, when the exchange, I'll do this in a minute. Now, there's another effect. When prices go up, according to the Fisher effect, if prices go up, interest rates go up. And if interest rates go up, higher interest rate makes the currency more attractive for investment. The exchange rate goes up. And this is called the interest rate parity. Alright, so this exchange rate going up is the effect for X standing for exports. If the exchange rate goes up, exports drop. But if the exchange rate goes down, exports increase. So, again, this first effect is short term, and the second effect is long term. So, it is very important that actually one of the most difficult topics in economics is to differentiate short-term effects from long-term effects. And in general, the long-term effects may be very different from the short-term effects. So, right now I'm only providing you two examples, which means that a great question for the final will be, provide two examples where short-term and long-term effects are different, okay? So, for example, you can go and have a party tonight, have fun, enjoy, have a good time. The short-term effect is great. Tomorrow on the quiz, the longer-term effect is lower score, right? Now, the opposite can be true. Short-term, you work hard, you sacrifice, okay? You study more, you invest in yourself. The long-term effect will be higher growth, higher salary, and so forth. So, in this particular case, coming back to your example from last time, the government can have a nice little party. We call it a, let's say, in our case from last Friday, it was a nice little party. What was the party? Well, a couple of hours, attack on Syria. That's $50 billion spending in 2 hours, okay? So they can have 2 hours of fireworks, and that's gonna be a great boost to the economy, short term. So short term, great. Long term is really bad for the American economy. Similarly here, if prices go up, short term, it will raise interest rates and provide a boost to exports, but long term, the effect will be opposite. So, effect on prices is through the exchange rate, short term is on the one side, and the long term is on the other side. Now, let me repeat again, we wrote it last time, just to summarize the three effects, and add the three effects if prices go up. If prices go up, the first was the wealth. And the wealth effect meant that, what is it? Prices go up, the purchases power goes down, right? The consumers feel poorer, and therefore the consumption goes down. Was that like that last time? No? Exactly the same? I had last time prices, all prices rise. If prices rise, what happens? Power falls, and what happens to consumption?
Less consumption.
Okay, second is the
interest rate
effect. If prices rise, interest rates rise, and interest rates rise, investment will fall. And three is the interest rate parity effect. If interest rates rise, the exchange rate will rise. And when the exchange rate rises, what happens to exports and imports?
Exports increase.
Exports increase.
Import
and incomes will decrease. So short term, you get three boosting effects. Three times you boost effects. Let's see what we have, just to make sure that I have it here. If prices actually rise, if prices increase, consumption increase, this has to be the opposite. It has to be the opposite. The exports, when exchange rate goes down, exchange rate goes up, exports go down, and this import goes up. From last time, that's what I was trying to explain. I gave you this second effect, okay? I gave you the long-term effect. So there is a short-term effect and the long-term effect. When prices go up, it is negative for consumption, negative for investment, negative for export, and therefore the following. When prices go up, it follows that consumption plus investment plus net exports go down and GDP falls. Okay? So, as prices go up, GDP falls, or demand, that's important, demand for GDP falls. And this is the explanation for the downward slope. Let's try again. Question. So, in the short run, the wealth effect, the interest rate effect, and the exchange rate effect work in the same direction. Okay? And if prices increase, GDP demand decreases. That's the reason why here you have the demand for GDP and the price level is falling because of these three separate effects. Okay, so that explains why it's downward sloping. Last time I covered, let's repeat it quickly. Shift in demand and shift in demand, number one, can be consumption going up. Why consumers will buy or spend more? Well, I gave you the example of optimism. For some reason, consumers feel better. For example, end of a war. Okay? The opposite. Consumption can go down because of a beginning of war, because of fear. Now, consumption can go up or down. It's called a wealth effect. Example will be, let's say, stock market crash. A lot of people here invest in the stock market. If the stock market crashes, they feel poorer, they don't spend as much. Example of a wealth effect may be real estate crash. The real estate market crashes, a lot of people lose a lot of money, they spend less. Of course, the wealth effect is usually works the opposite. If the stock market goes up, people feel good, they spend more. If real estate market goes up, they feel rich, they feel making a lot of money, they feel a lot smarter, they say, geez, I'm so smart. I buy real estate 3, let's say, years ago. Before, it was 1 million. Now, 2 million, right? I'm so smart. And they can go and spend a lot more money. That's the wealth effect, okay? Exactly, you have number two, investment. If businesses and businessmen, managers feel more optimistic, The economy is doing great. Everything is doing great. Of course, they see stock market going up, real estate market going up. They see consumers optimistic. They'll simply invest more, usually. Borrow more and invest more. The opposite, if they see stock market crash, real estate market crash, danger of war or war beginning or something else happening, they spend less. Now, here there is one other extremely important indicator which can boost overall feeling for the economy, which is different from the rest of the world, and that's simply price of oil. You see oil prices going up, 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 and up. We all know that everyone's going to be a whole lot richer. You know that if oil prices go $10 or $20 up, there's going to be a whole lot more billions of dollars floating in the economy, okay? So we're going to have a lot more billions for everyone around. So simply watching the price of oil go up will result in a lot bigger optimism. Now, the opposite, of course, is also true. Oil prices crashing can literally depress people and the economy at the same time. So, investments can go up for a whole bunch of independent reasons or go down. And similarly, could be exports. Exports especially will depend a lot on foreign economies. It depends here, exports depend on, is the Chinese economy growing? Is the European economy growing? Is the American economy growing? Wherever there is demand for oil. So these are factors that will shift the curve, demand curve. And number four, government. Government decide to spend more. Like, remember, 2-hour party in Syria last Friday? That's when It has a short-term boost for the economy and then a long-term negative effect for the economy. But in 2 hours, they can quickly spend $50 billion. In just 2 hours, and that's going to be a massive boost for the economy, okay? Stock market actually goes up, okay? So, government spending, in this case, for example, Donald Trump says we're going to build new roads, new infrastructure. That can have short-term positive effects. Even building a wall will have a short-term positive effect. All right, so all of these are factors that first, this one is why demand curve is downward sloping. And the second is what might be different causes to shift demand. In other words, these are causes could be totally external to the economy, okay? Like the price of oil, totally external to the economy. They may be external to the economy, like stock markets in America crash, and the next day they crash in Asia and here, okay? Completely different. They can be external to the economy, like global financial crisis crashes European and American economy, and just a couple of days later, the global financial crisis comes here. It usually takes 1 or 2 or 3 days, no more than that, okay? So these are completely external factors. Or they can be internal, like the government decides to build more roads, more schools, more hospitals, whatever the story. So these are, again, standard questions. What are some general causes or reasons or ways that demand curve shifts? Now, moving on to the next section, supply curve. Supply curve, again, this is the same explanation of what I started. In the long run, supply curve is vertical. So this is the supply curve. And it is vertical, meaning no matter what the price level is in the long run, supply depends on what were the resources, what were the four reasons, the four resources. Supply long-term depends on resources in the economy. What were the resources in the economy?
Natural resources.
Yes, number one, natural. Natural resources. Remember, natural resources, we explained in growth, is the least important of all. Yes, human capital. We just call it labor. Labor and human capital. What else? What else?
Capital.
Hmm? Yes, capital. Just plain capital. And there was one more.
Money.
Hmm? No, not money.
Information and resources.
Yeah, information in general, technology. Alright, so this is the long run horizontal. How or what will make the curve shift outward? What will shift long term? What will shift long term supply? Okay, let's see here. What will shift long-term supply? Question. Everyone's having fun, right? All right, what will shift supply?
Money.
Huh? Money? Well, money is the one thing that will not shift it. Money is the one thing that will not shift supply.
You're talking about factors?
Hmm?
Factors?
Yes, change in factors. Example number one. Increase in labor. How will labor increase? You guys need to take a break, 10 minutes or 20 minutes? No, no, no. Alright, they're just having fun. Alright, so, first of all, yeah, alright, well, we'll need to take a 10-5 minute break, because foreign investments increase
capital.
Education increases human capital. Education increases human capital. And let's see what else we have. Natural resources will be natural resource discovery.
You go.
You discover more. There was just recently huge oil discovery, like past week.
Yes, Bahrain.
In Bahrain. Excellent answer. Was that a bonus point, right? Yes, in Bahrain. In Bahrain, they discovered huge oil field. Well, that will provide possibly short term,
but very likely
long term boost to the economy. So in the long run, supply curve, in this case for Bahrain, will shift to the right.
Okay.
Of course, a country may discover diamonds, they may discover all sorts of other things. And what about, again, foreign investments, and it will be also technology. I'll provide only one example, but it could provide like thousands of examples, like wind energy, okay? You create wind energy. Another one will be water type energy, solar type energy, nuclear type energy. This is just a simple example of a mixture of technology with possibly with resources, okay? So, education, whatnot, okay. And I still have to write resources, right? Again?
Natural.
Yes, natural resources, yes.
So, you understand that low-cost capital will increase capital?
Yes, low-cost capital in this particular case. Yes. Low-cost capital simply comes from savings, either people saving more at home or import cheap capital from abroad. Example, the cheapest capital in the world now is in Japan. Japan has very cheap capital. Now, the Japanese don't invest much at home. They take all their capital and invest it all abroad. In other words, demand for Japanese capital in Japan is very low. There is a huge supply of Japanese savings, which results in high supply of Japanese capital. So, in Japan, demand is low, supply is high, and Japanese capital is overall cheapest in the world. Okay. So, cheap capital, usually Japanese capital, some other capital, will come as foreign investments. Okay. Now, it could come as, we can write it separately, foreign capital and investments. Maybe American companies will invest here, maybe Chinese companies want to invest here, maybe Russian, whatever companies want to invest in here from around the world, yeah?
So, if in Japan the supply is high and the demand is low, why is the cost of living expensive there?
Oh, that's a different story. That's for you to write a little paper on. Living expenses are very different. In other words, you have what's called the cost of capital, and the other one is cost of living. Cost of living is something very different. It relates to standard of living, like cost of living in Switzerland, extremely expensive. In Japan, extremely expensive. A country can be very, very rich, okay, and have a high cost of living, but a country can be very poor and still have a very high cost of living. For example, high cost of living is in the Philippines. Even though the country is very poor, they have a very high cost of living. Another place with a very high cost of living is Moscow in Russia. Russia is relatively poor country, but Moscow is a city. It's extremely, extremely expensive. Okay, so cost of living is also associated with spending. There's too much domestic spending. You know, people have a lot of money and they buy things. Okay, the same thing. Cost of living in Dubai, a lot expensive. Very expensive. Could be twice as expensive as just 100 kilometers from here. Okay, and at the same time, cost of living. For example, in Saudi Arabia, it's a lot lower. I live in Saudi Arabia, but it was way cheaper. So, cost of living is determined by completely different things. All right, so this is the aggregate supply curve, and this is, let me write it out, shift in supply curve, shift in aggregate supply curve. And so, shifts can result in changes in labor, changes in capital, in education, in technology, in natural resources. And now we need one other simple question. Let me see where I'm going to write it. I'm going to write it here. Why the short-term curve is upward sloping. In other words, this is the long run curve, and this is the short run curve. In other words, in the short run, higher prices will result in more GDP. Okay? And the question is, why? So, upward sloping supply curve. The question is why this happens. There are a number of theories, and that should be hopefully, yes, the end of the chapter and the end of this course. Well, I already gave you one simple example. Let me just write it out. It's not exactly a theory, but let's write it out. Harder effort for example, salaries go up for 2, 3, 6 months. People will work a lot harder, okay? I mean, you can't make people work harder for 2 years or 10 years, but you can make them work harder for 1 month, 2 months, maybe even up to a year, okay? If everyone's making a lot more money, they'll just work a lot more. Instead of 8 hours a day, they're going to work 10 hours a day. Instead of 5 days a week, they're going to work 6 days a week. If it's a taxi, I gave an example, instead of running the taxi for 16 hours, they're going to run it for 18. Going to run it for 20 hours. So there's simply harder effort. Well, number two, it's called sticky wages and sticky wage theory. Sticky wages or sticky wage theory. Well, what does it mean? It means the following. Wages don't adjust quickly. A lot of people anywhere in the world, including here, work on contract. And some people have a 1 year contract, some people have a 2 year contract, some people may have a 3 year contract. And the contract is for a fixed salary. Well, what does it mean that sticky wage theory. If I have a 3-year contract, a okay? And I'm working for the same salary, same salary, same salary, same salary, but there's a little bit of an inflation going on in the country. This means that my salary or my wage goes down. Well, let's explain this. Sticky wage theory means the following. If prices go up, the purchasing power of wage, purchasing power of wage goes down. In other words, I'm working for the same salary. I get the same money, but it buys me less. It's effectively my salary goes down. If my salary goes down, the result for businesses, more profit or less profit? You see?
More profit.
More profit. In other words, think of it this way. I got the same salary for 3 years. There is inflation of 10%. I still get next year the same salary, but they raise the price of tuition for 10%. So the business can raise the price, but keep the salary the same. So the wage goes down, profit goes up. And if profit goes up, supply will go up. Supply goes up. Okay? In other words, sticky wage theory basically says because wages are fixed, inflation causes falling real wages, higher profits, and higher profits leads to higher short-term supply. Maybe in the long run there will be more competition, other things will happen in the long run. So this is the sticky wage theory. Second is three, sticky price theory. Sticky price theory means the following. Well, there's a lot of inflation everywhere. Salaries will go up, profits will go up, but because of menu costs, some things remain at the same old price. And if they remain at the same old price, you say, oh, this has gotten cheaper. People will buy more. So sticky price theory simply means that overall prices increase, okay, but some prices remain fixed. For example, a hotel has advertised that it will be this price, okay? A lot of people purchase the hotel room, they paid for it long time before that, prices go up. So some prices increase, okay, but some prices remain fixed. They can't raise them or they wait to raise them. In other words, sometimes some wages and salaries will not increase, but sometimes some prices will not increase. And the result will be, oh, this thing has gotten a lot cheaper. People buy more. So result is that there will be more buying. In other words, demand will increase or quantity demand will increase in the short run. In other words, oh, this thing is cheaper now. This happens actually a lot with cars, especially used cars. It can happen even with new cars. They set the price for a while and then the price remains the same for the whole year. Okay, they can't change the price easily. And the result is, oh, this thing is a lot cheaper. Let's see.
Sticky price, you mean fixed price?
Yes, sticky means fixed. Cannot change the price quickly and easily for some particular reasons. Again, some wages may be increased quickly, but some wages, they remain the same. It's very hard. I mean, I can't change my wage, even if prices double. Not now,
Okay, not in the middle of a contract, especially people for 2 or 3 years contract, okay? And same thing, some suppliers will have, for some reason, fixed prices, okay? And for some reason, for example, they have a long-term contract. For the next 2 years, you're going to be supplying me whatever for a fixed price. So we have a contract wage or we have a contract price. Or the price may have been advertised. Or, example, for hotels. Here's an example of a hotel. Hotel will advertise for next season, okay? And they'll advertise a particular price. And you may or actually pay with your credit card. Or they may make a reservation, and the reservation is you pay now 10%, and when it comes December, you can do whatever. Same thing could be with airplane tickets. Airplane tickets, you can book and fix the price 3, 6, 9 months in advance. Same thing with hotels, same thing with cars. So a lot of prices in the economy don't adjust from today till next week. It may take 3 months or 2 years for the price to adjust. So this will also result in a short-term upward slope of supply. And finally, they have what is called, again, the misperceptions theory. And misperceptions theory is that suppliers are misled. Misleads suppliers means the following. There is a general overall inflation. All prices rise. But if you're a supplier, and I'm just picking a supplier of wood, okay? You cannot usually see that there is a general inflation. All you see is that your price is fixed. There is more demand for your wood, which is at the old lower price. And you just sell more of it, okay? Without raising. It could apply for coal, it could apply for agricultural products, it could apply for watermelons or rice or something. Okay. In other words, if there is an inflation here and demand increases overall, the supplier in the Philippines or in Thailand wouldn't know that. So they will not raise their price.
Fixed.
The old price. It's not fixed. Here, the price is fixed. Because of a contract, because of a previous agreement, because you purchased for, fixed the airplane. You fixed the price 9 months ago, you cannot change it. Here, they don't really realize. A farmer in India or a farmer in Thailand wouldn't realize that the price has actually changed, okay? They can't see the inflation effect here. Okay, and their currency may be falling, so they think you're still getting the same price, but it's a currency. In other words, they get a little bit fooled. So all of these short-term reasons are here, especially these three are what's called market imperfections. For some reason, the market does not work well in the short run. The price does not adjust, the salary doesn't adjust next week. It takes 3 months or 2 years for the price to adjust. The salary here, it takes 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months for prices to adjust, okay? And here, again, farmers, it may take 1 or 2 years for the prices to adjust. And by the time they adjust the prices, more inflation goes up and makes even more. Okay? Now, here, suppliers may be the following. For example, there's a huge real estate boom, and they may be demand for electrical supplies. And whoever is sending the wires and the electric plugs, whatever it is, they can't see that there is a general inflation, so they sell it a little cheaper. Okay? And they just work more, work hard. But these are all short-term
curve, short curve. All right, let's see what I have, because I'm pretty much done. So, these are basic reasons why supply curve is upward sloped. So, the questions basically were, okay, why demand curve is downward sloping, and what shifts the demand curve? Then the other questions are, why the long-term supply curve is vertical, what shifts the long-term supply curve, and why the short-term supply curve is upward sloping, okay? And basically we got to the idea that in the short run, you have, downward sloping demand curve. We call it aggregate demand, AD. And you have upward sloping aggregate supply curve. This is GDP, and this is the price level. Long term.